The hidden truth about AWS availability zones. What if I told you that what you thought you knew about AWS availability zones was all a lie, and you're potentially putting your infrastructure resiliency at risk and causing unnecessary data transfer costs every month? Hi, everyone, and welcome to the channel. In this video, I'll be diving into a little known detail about AWS availability zones that could have a really big impact on your AWS costs and may also impact your entire AWS infrastructure and how it responds during AZ failure scenarios. So we know that AWS regions typically have between 3 to 6 AZs to choose from to help build in some resiliency into our AWS workload designs in case of a entire AZ failure scenario. But what you may not know is that a hidden detail about the AZ name itself could have some very important impacts to your costs and workload resiliency. Now, I won't get into what AWS availability zones are here in this video, but I have some other videos on the channel covering this if you need a bit of a refresher. But AZs are really an important piece of the AWS global infrastructure and allow us as AWS customers to design our workloads with high availability in mind. Now, we should have a general understanding that the AWS AZs are made up of one or more data center facilities behind the scenes. If we have AZ1, AZ2, and AZ3 in our example region here, maybe AZ1 has 3 facilities powering it, and same with AZ2. Then perhaps AZ3 has 2 data centers. Now, I'm using these AZ names for simplicity, but you'll see your AZ names as US East 1A, for example, US East 1B, and so on, just depending on the AWS region and how many AZs are available in it. Now, imagine for a moment that you're AWS, and you have millions of users in a given region who all want to deploy resources into it. Now, due to the pure number of customers in that region, if we had a default AZ of AZ1 for customers, you can expect that there'd be a significant amount of resources being deployed in that first AZ. This could just be that a lot of customer workloads simply don't require multi-AZ considerations, or they may just want 2 AZ redundancy for a workload, so AZ1 and AZ2 are selected. Now, these 2 scenarios alone could cause a lot of uneven distribution of resources across the available AZs. Now, we could probably guess as a general distribution in a region where default AZ1 may have 70% of all the resources in it, and then AZ2 may have 20%, and AZ3 may have just 10% for the customers that need additional resiliency for their workloads. Now, if we're AWS here and trying to manage all the hardware of each underlying facility making up these AZs, it'd be really a nightmare to keep growing AZ1 bigger and bigger over time. And then from a cost perspective, why would we build more data centers in an existing AZ and buy more hardware when we have other AZs largely sitting idle in that region? So to address this AZ distribution problem, AWS uses a simple load balancing trick to balance resources across AZs. And this naming trick is where some really important considerations come into play. Basically, all AWS does here is just randomize the AZ mapping of the AZ name to the actual physical AZ location for each AWS account. So as a quick example, account A's AZ1 here may be the same physical location of account B's AZ3. So with a randomization of the AZ names with a scale of hundreds of thousands to millions of AWS accounts, the default AZ and the AZ selection of AWS customers within a region gets better balanced across the physical AZ locations. Now, let's take a moment to think of some of the consequences of this AZ remapping stuff. So if we say we have a larger multi-account AZ organization structure with a number of AWS accounts serving a type of shared services function where there may be some analytics or compute functionality or even security services for workloads in different accounts to share or scan the traffic. Now, if you're designing workloads that are utilizing 2 AZs, say AZ1 and AZ2, but those rely on shared resources running in other AWS accounts, which also have 2 AZ designed to them, you would likely assume that if you use the same AZ names in both accounts, you'd be doing the right thing. With the workload spanning multiple accounts aligned to the same AZs, you can better understand and predict the AZ failure scenarios. But this isn't actually the case. So if we take a look at the AWS documentation around this to better understand what's taking place under the hood. From this example diagram in the documentation, we can see that Count 1's US East 1A availability zone maps to the actual physical AZ ID of US E1 AZ1. But now if we take a look at Account 2 here, the same AZ name of US East 1A now actually points to a completely different AZ with the AZ ID of US E1 AZ3. So where can all this stuff actually become a problem? So if you had a workload that spans two AWS accounts that requires some high availability of different components, and you decide to spread them out over two or more AZs, you may want to selectively decide the distribution and quantity of resources in each of the AZs so you can predict what occurs when a specific AZ failure was to happen. Maybe you've got 10 front-end EC2 instances load balanced across AZ1 and AZ2 in the first account, but these rely on other back-end systems to work. So in account 2, you deploy 10 other back-end components in the same AZ1 and AZ2. Now with a random AZ mapping to these physical AZ locations and its AZ ID, the resources may actually be in different physical AZs. So if an AZ fails here, some random subset of the expected resources may go offline and really cause this unexpected behavior in the application. Now within a single AWS account, the AZ names don't really matter much as they'd all be the same AZ. But it's when you start introducing other accounts and start doing VPC peering between them to send traffic across for accessing different shared services using the AWS Resource Access Manager or other shared service use cases. This data transfer cost can be very substantial. Now, AWS data transfer costs are always a bit of a challenge to figure out. But if we look at some AWS documentation and tools, we can see that by ensuring we have alignment of the actual physical AZ IDs between our accounts, we can potentially save a ton of money depending on how much data is actually being transferred. So back in 2021, AWS started offering free data transfer across VPC peering connections, but with a huge caveat that the data transfer occurs within the same AZ, which is known as intra-AZ traffic. We can also cross-check this with the latest AWS VPC documentation, which echoes that the VPC peering traffic between accounts is free, but only if it's intra-AZ traffic. If data is sent across different AZs or inter-AZ traffic, this is charged at that cross-AZ transfer rate. We can also triple check all this with the new AWS Network Cost Calculator tool. If you haven't seen this tool yet, it's essentially an AWS pricing calculator specific for AWS networking costs. Now, it's a really helpful tool in my opinion, as it's always really struggle to understand all the nuanced details of the data transfer costs for specific scenarios for different AWS services and their inherent functions like backups and cross-region replication and so forth. Now, AWS provides this tool as a self-hosted solution, so you need to deploy it yourself for some reason, but it's very straightforward to deploy. But once it's actually up and running, you can go in here and essentially pick your different networking components, and it'll provide you with a visual representation of the network connectivity and data transfer costs along with those transfer paths to help you calculate those expected costs. So if you go back to our VPC peering across accounts example scenario here, we can see this represented with the VPC peering selection, where we have a EC2 instance in account B sitting in VPC B and AZ1 using a VPC peering connection here to VPC D in account D. Now, note the inter-AZ costs here. So across these different AZ, the costs are 1 cent per gigabyte for that data transfer. Now, further gotcha with cross-AZ traffic is it's metered and charged in both directions, effectively costing 2 cents per gigabyte. You're essentially paying at both ends of the toll bridge for that cross-AZ traffic. So again, really depending on your workloads and how much traffic is going across these peering connections, the difference between free intra-AZ data transfer versus paying 2 cents per gigabyte for inter-AZ traffic can be potentially thousands of dollars a month. So what should we actually do about this AWS AZ randomization trick to really ensure our infrastructure resiliency is designed as we expect and that we're not paying thousands of dollars for unnecessary cross-AZ data transfer? Well, it essentially comes down to us as AWS customers having to do our own mapping of the physical AZ ID to the randomized AZ names that we see in each of our accounts. Now, AWS does have a solution example for us for this exact scenario that leverages the SSM parameter store to essentially create a key value lookup to help us align each account's AZ names to the unique AZ ID. And you can then reference the parameter store for our CloudFormation templates to ensure consistency, or if we're using other infrastructure as code tools like Terraform, We can ensure that we're using, for our subnets, using the availability zone ID to specify the physical AZ ID rather than just using the AZ name with the availability zone argument. And there's also data source lookups in Terraform we can do to for the AZ names to essentially dynamically retrieve the availability zone names and AZ IDs for our accounts, and then manage that mapping however works best for you. So I hope you found this video interesting and learned something new about AWS AZs. That innocent little load balancing trick AWS does by randomizing the AZ names can really have big impacts if you're doing a lot of data transfer between accounts over VPC peering connections, private link endpoints, or sharing resources using AWS Resource Access Manager. Now, if you weren't already aware of this AZ naming trickery going on, and especially if you have a lot of data transfer occurring between different accounts in your organization, to take some time and understand the true AZ ID the resources are actually deployed in, and what the implications are of AZ failure scenarios when those hidden cross-AZ data transfer costs. Now, let me know in the comments here if this AZ naming stuff has caused you some large data transfer costs in the past, or you've had other unexpected impacts as a result, and really what solution you use to ensure your resources and network traffic go to the intended places. So that's it. Until next time, thanks so much for watching and see you in the next one.